Hi, good morning. A very happy new year. And in this video, we'll talk about why fintechs are required all the more now. So this video or video blog has been inspired by Copenhagen Business School. And I'd really like to thank Stephen Henningsen and Clay Kristen from Harvard Business School for helping me shape the content of this video. Without much ado, let's start why fintechs are required. So there are three basic things which is the main core and crux of forming a fintech. First is called the innovator's dilemma. Then it's called the immunization that is there in your organization. And third is the hyper competition. So with these three theories, we'll look at why traditional IT organizations is no longer working and why fintech revolution is there and why the fintech industry is ripe to accept that type of innovation. So let's look at innovator's dilemma. So the idea behind innovator's dilemma is that there are two types of innovation. One is breakthrough innovation, which happens on the value chain. I'm producing X, can I produce the same amount of X but with more value? Like in car industry, you are producing the same car, you are solving the same need, but on you're playing on the wants, where somebody may want auto parking, somebody may want better sensors, somebody may want better comfort, and you're playing on the value chain, and hence you're moving into the niche segment where you're satisfying the wants of certain people and taking value through that. The second is disruptive innovation, which is the crux of the topic here, because financial industry is very ripe for disruptive innovation. In disruptive innovation, what happens is that instead of fighting for a value chain and becoming more and more niche, you bring down the value of the goods and services you are offering such that it becomes much more economical for the masses and the industry opens up. And the disruptor does that by lowering the value but increasing the commerciality of the service. The examples for this are Uber, where Uber has stopped giving you an 8 hours dedicated chauffeur driven car service. But what Uber offers is a very economical value driven service where as soon as you are done with your journey, you are ready to let off the taxi go, and there is a promise that anytime you will need it later, you can have that taxi or somebody else will drive you home. Similar is the case with Airbnb, where they are not offering best hotels or best services in hotels. They are giving economical stay so that you can visit different countries because your need is to travel, not to enjoy the last end of the services offered by the hotel industry. So if you see this graph, generally what happens is that the market leader plays on this, where it increases the value, becomes niche because the market coverage decreases for him. But for a disruptive innovation, let's say Uber, Airbnb, or any of the mobile payment wallets that have come across, they are trying to increase the market coverage by decreasing the value and only focusing on need. And from here, the value curve starts rising. So the disruptor's value curve starts rising here, and then market leaders become very much scared for the fact that why disruptor is having a high pace or increase in the value that they are delivered. And if this is a customer segmentation, they are not focusing on niche, they are focusing on the mass, and from the scale, they are generating the profits that is required. The second effect is immunization. Immunization is like whenever a foreign body enters a system, like a human body, then there are chemicals and then there is a fight so as to kill that foreign body. Similar is the case with the fintech, where their immunization comes from two levels. One is the division and the department level, and the second is a personal level. Let's talk about the personal level first. So whenever a fintech would try to enter a traditional IT organization, people will try to shut it down. And the main reason to shut it down a few, and these are my personal experiences also, because I myself have been promoting fintechs and the fintech thought process. where I've faced a lot of challenges by the traditional IT organization because of this personal immunization, which is a person, let's say there was a manager, and I went ahead with a very good idea on the fintech innovation on the services offered. And this person will say that you're talking about the value creation, which is maybe 10 or 12 times, but why are you talking about that? Why don't we work about an incremental way of change, which is 10% change or 20% change? Because I'll get the same bonus whether I do a 12 times change or 20% change. The organization will only reward me in this year for a 20% savings or 20% increment in value that has to be created. So first is a bonus culture that is there. The second is the agency cost of retirement. So I took the same idea to a person who was, let's say, 58 years old, and I told him, sir, why don't we implement this because it will get more revenue. And his thought process was that it's too much of a change. Near my retirement, I don't want to take so much of a risk, and hence I would not like to go ahead with that sort of an idea. Let's go calmly, where again 20% hike or value creation is required, because then I will be able to show that I retired successfully and you will be able to pick it up from there. So a traditional IT organization will always believe on 10% change, 20% change, because that's how they have the thought process has been. A young entrepreneur will not go ahead because of the bonus culture, and an experienced person would not go ahead because he doesn't want to ruin his retirement. The third part of it is stability. Obviously, there would be parts of the organization which would not want you to come down the value curve because they feel that the system is becoming more stable. They don't realize that you're moving down the value curve, and that's your thought way of going ahead and doing things. But they see that you're causing instability in the values delivered to the customer. So the second part of that is a personal aspect of immunization bias. The division and the department aspect of immunization bias is coming from the fact that cannibalization of existing product of services would happen, which will disturb department, which would disturb the leader in the department. And hence they will avoid, or they will create disruptions for you. The aspect of that is, excellent aspect of that is the Kodak services. So Kodak had a film industry business where they were producing films. With the digital cameras coming in, Kodak had that digital camera from 1960s onwards. They didn't want to promote that digital camera because cannibalization of film industry would occur. And hence that division, which was making profit, would go down. This was a severe cannibalization that was seen to the film industry, and hence the commercialization of digital camera never happened. Again, the immunization bias comes into perspective, where people will not like to commercialize. Even if you have got a good idea, they'll not like to commercialize your idea and take it forward. So in order to ensure that FinTech survives, you'll have to protect the embryotic innovation, which can only happen if the CEO or CIO, not even the CIO, but most probably the CEO of the organization would have to spend on the FinTech part of it. The business directly have to contribute to it. The traditional IT organization owning a FinTech organization or an R&D department, which they call it, will not at all help, because of these two biases that are there. The third is a hyper competition, which is the industry level change, where rather than focusing on sustainable competitive advantage, like you'll produce something and then you'll sell it for 100 years, which was the way in which we have been taught management. At least this was the best strategy question that I used to get in my management degree, that what is the Viro principle or valuable rare thing that you will be able to go ahead and generate, and how, what is a sustainable competitive advantage from that? Because they thought that the value curve is like this, that first there will be a rise in value, then the value will plateau out for a long period of time, and then it will fall. But the hyper competition is a state of the industry, and I think fintech industry is ripe for that, is where continuous innovations are happening at a regular interval and at a very fast interval. And in this type of industry, which could last from next 2 to 10 years approximately, there'll be short value curves that would be there. So it would be like a movie industry. What movie industry is there? Whenever a good movie comes, they will focus on putting it on as many screens as possible so that the value can be realized quickly and in a short period of time before the next movie comes in. And hence, it is a very strategic mindset change, because then you'll have to believe in the constant change, where your skills will become outdated very soon, your incentives will become outdated very soon, your resources and your action plan will become outdated very soon. Since these are becoming outdated, you have to be in a constant phase of changing yourself, and your organization and the culture in your organization and the people in your organization should also adapt to that quickly as much as possible. So that's what I'm saying, that short period of high gain is what we should be targeting for next 5 to 10 years, because that is where the value will lie. So there are three things why fintechs are required in your organization now. First is the innovator's dilemma, where you'll have to come down the value curve so as to create new products and services which can appeal to the masses and to the generation X that is present. The second is the immunization bias, which is how to protect the fintech in your organization, because people will have their personal bias and there will be a division and department bias that could exist. Last is the hyper competition, where you'll have to move away from the concept of sustainable competitive advantage, but would have to adopt the continuous improvement process or a continuous change process in your organization to realize the value in short sprints. Thank you.